What's going on, everyone? Welcome back to the channel. It's your boy Dead on Dave, and if you see the creepy green graphics, you know what time it is yet again. That's right, it is five random questions time, and I am joined today for a very special live five random questions with a longtime friend, really cool guy, and you might know him, a Vince Russo's. Yes, that Vince Russo, the brand. It is Andre friggin' Corbeil. What's going on, my friend?
How you doing, Dave? Glad to be on five random questions. Kind of feel like I'm putting myself under the bus here, but I trust you enough over there in Germany, Dave. How you doing, brother?
Pretty good, man. You're a brave man entering these waters. No, it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it, man. This is
Why do I hear the freaking Jaws theme going on in the background?
He walked into the trap, folks. Will he get out alive? Find out now on five random questions. Yeah. No, I'm really looking forward to this, man. I appreciate you taking some time out of your busy schedule to join me here. You're the first ever live member of five random questions. So this is a
unique. So we're diving activity in the pool right away.
Exactly, right? Hopefully it will not be empty. I'm telling you. I'm glad you dressed up for the occasion, too.
Thank God I'm repping the great one, so I'm pretty confident with this one.
As you should be. I mean, in Wayne, we all trust.
Hey, did you hear the breaking news regarding the Edmonton Oilers, Dave?
Yes, I did. Connor McDavid, the youngest captain in NHL history. That's incredible.
Yeah. That's incredible. And I think he's ready, too.
I think you might be right about that. I know Tommy C, my good buddy Tommy C over Schaff in the Point, does not think he's ready, but I think you might be right about that.
I bet you if it was on Chicago, it would be a different opinion.
For me, yes. I have an agreement, though.
Didn't they promote a young captain? So
we did. That's very true. That's very, very true. See, we're already learning things. We're learning things about Andre Corbeil. All right, Mr. Corbeil. This is how this works. I don't know. I'm sure you've seen the show before. Really simple. I ask you five random questions, and if you survive all five and you answer them to my pleasure, you get to turn the tables on me, ask me anything you like. And being in the unique position you are, I mean, you're in the industry and you're a fan of you have that really unique perspective that even Dustin Starr, my first ever actual wrestler that I've had on, didn't have. You're like Blade. You're that daywalker, you know? It's kind of wonderful. You walk in both worlds. So if there's any questions that you might have to throw on a fat podcasting wrestling douche, you could throw it right at me. So it'd be wonderful.
You're a pretty complex fellow there, Dave. So I'm sure I'll have something in a cauldron for you, buddy.
All right. Sounds good to me. Are you ready to begin?
Born ready.
All right. Let's do this thing. Question.
Hey, nice thumbnail, brother.
Oh yeah, you like that, huh? Yeah, I got artsy with it. But when I'm working with a beautiful canvas such as you, it's so easy to do. So, you know, and I appreciate that. Fuck. All right, random.
Am I allowed to swear randomly?
Yes, of course. Fuck shit balls. Yes, absolutely, no problem. All right, here we go. Question number one. Wrestling has always had a unique relationship with its fans, as you know, and vice versa, you know, fandom and wrestling. Fans have been let into the world of wrestling in the last 20 years more than ever before. And things that were known and understood with a wink and a smile are now fully being acknowledged and, for all intents and purposes, embraced. As someone that sees that more than most, why do you think that is? And ultimately, is all of this death of kayfabe a good thing?
Well, the death of kayfabe, Dave, is a two-layered curtain. That's how I'll present it to you, wrestling fans. Yes, the first layer, the first curtain has been opened and exposed to the fans, but take it from someone that works inside the business and views the business from a fan's perspective as well, like you led in, Dave. Yeah. There's still that one curtain closed for the fans. There's lots that y'all don't know, and I'm not saying that to be arrogant. I'm not pointing the finger at anyone saying, oh, you're not in the know, this and that and that and this, because there's different levels pertaining and relating to each different fan abroad. But there is that secondary curtain, Dave, and there are a lot of secrets. I thought I knew it all before I started working with the Hart family, and I still have a lot to learn.
It's pretty incredible that there is that, you're 100% right too. There is that second, probably even third layer that most people don't even know about. And yet we feel as fans that we're connected with it. But it's one of those things, Roddy Piper said it best. Every time that we think we have all the answers, wrestling changes the question. I think it's kind of one of the reasons why we love it so much.
Touche, Dave. Touche.
Do you think, though, with Triple H, famously, not that long ago on Stone Cold Steve Austin, this is a little bit follow-up, a little rider to that one question. Triple H famously on the Stone Cold Steve Austin podcast not long ago said the words, kayfabe is dead. Was he just talking about that first layer? Is that really what he's talking about? Or do you think the second layer, that second curtain, will ever be revealed? And should it?
I personally think, weeding all the crap out, Dave, that was Paul Levesque catering to the fans.
Ooh.
Saying that. Making them feel good.
I think you might be right there.
You know, it feels better when you're welcome along for the ride, right?
Absolutely. You can get things a lot. You can get things by people a lot quicker when you put an arm around them. So, yeah, you know,
and
I think you're right.
Pulling a 180, Dave, I understand where that question came from. You go to that child that was consoled by Triple H in the front row when he broke kayfabe, yeah. Stephanie as well. If you go back on WWE Monday Night Raw, there are instances within that first curtain and maybe a peek through that second curtain. But, hey, you put it even better than I did, Dave. That proverbial third curtain is definitely a possibility. Yeah. So,
awesome. Well, I appreciate the candid answer there. That, you know, that was even better than I was expecting. I got to be honest with you. Before we go on question two, I got a good friend that I think you know. His name is Frenchie Ben. He works with Shot from the Point. Good guy. Awesome guy. He's Montreal, Quebec, Canada's greatest. That's right. Yes. That is Frenchie Ben.
Les habitants, Frenchie! Les habitants! Vive le Québec!
Anyway, that's right. That's my man. And I actually, I ran by some questions because, you know, when you're asking Canadians questions, you got to be very careful. And, you know, because you don't want to just get all politeness back, right? So I ran it by Frenchie, and he thought the answer that we were going to get to that first question was going to be the standard answer that always comes up when kayfabe is talked about, you know, going to the curtain call and all that stuff. But you went a different way, and that's exactly why you're here, man. Thank you for that wonderful answer.
All right.
I promise I will not suck your balls after each and every answer. I promise you that. But that was a great answer.
Am I going to have to get some Dave spray?
Yeah, you might have to. Even that might not keep me away. I don't know, Andre. Question number two, my friend. Are you ready? All right. As we opened, as we said right from the beginning, it's no secret that you're a Vince Russo guy. You work for the brand. You're part of the brand. But it wasn't all that long ago that you were in the Bill After camp over at OneWrestling.com. It goes without saying that from an outside perspective looking in, it would appear as you went from one extreme to the other. Why leave After for Russo? That's my big question. What happened? Why?
Two words.
Yeah.
Two words. Creative control.
Oh.
Now, as a guy that reported for One Wrestling and was discovered by Bill After and Big Ray and given a chance on that stage, mm-hmm. Bill After has been an editor for decades. Think of the After mags.
Yeah.
Bill was the editor for those. So he's used to going through things and over things with a fine tooth comb.
Mm-hmm.
I love Bill with my heart. I actually always will.
He's a legend.
But it was a little hard working for someone that wanted you to stay in the middle without veering into the controversial aspects. Mm. Bill and I didn't see eye to eye pertaining and relating to that. And I respect Bill's view, angles, and way of presenting the business. It's professional. And I did that for close to 3 years. Vince Russo offered me my own show with 100% creative control.
Oh, wow.
I'm happy to be at the brand. Vince, a little hard to deal with.
Yes.
But what many people don't understand about Vince Russo, they see the brash Vince Russo. They see the guy that throws insults out there, the guy that puts people on the spot.
Sure.
People need to know that Vince actually has a great sense of humor. And you go to team settings, whether it be football, volleyball, hockey, whatever. Jabbing, prodding, poking, that's a part of a team atmosphere. And in a team atmosphere, that's actually a way of showing love.
Yeah, absolutely. It's respect. A locker room mentality. I agree with that.
That's right. That's right. So I think a lot of people take Vince Russo the wrong way and fail to view him in that aspect or light.
Yeah, and I think
Vince is great to work for.
Yeah, go ahead.
Vince is great to work for. He's only gave me shit twice.
You know,
but I love the creative control. I love the freedom. I love to be able to build my show without being worried about diving into the hot tub, you know?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's always hard when you're working with somebody who micromanages on that level, you know? So I get that. And it's interesting because one of the first times that you and I actually had an encounter was on Twitter, and you actually gave me some advice, and it was based off of, I don't know if you remember this or not, but you actually gave me some advice.
Was it language?
Yes, it was about language. And you cited Bill Apter for that. And it's just, it's incredible to me. And I think it's a really good creative decision just for, you know, your own creative juices to be able to move on and take what you've learned from Bill and be able to move into the realm of Russo, because it is, it's walking into a completely different situation. And I got to applaud you for that. It's a pretty ballsy thing to do, because I think you're right. I think there is a lot of misconceptions about Vince Russo, and it's because Vince is a meme more than anything else. You know, Vince is blamed fairly or unfairly for a lot of the fall of the greatest era in wrestling, you know, and
because it's easy for people.
It is, you know?
It's easy for people to dish the blame off on other people.
Yeah. And there's, believe me,
Hillary Clinton.
Uh-oh.
No, let's not go politics. I'm sorry.
Right.
I shouldn't have even went.
No, it's okay. I'm in 100% agree. I'd vote for a frog over Hillary Clinton. Okay. I'm so that's completely.
Hey, that makes you racist, Dave.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I'm a misogynist. I don't want no woman. No, I just don't want a corrupt, evil woman. It has nothing to do with women. It's corrupt, evil woman.
Going back to Bill Apter and me pulling the 180 and migrating to the brand, I never would have been ready to do that if I wasn't sanded, prepared, and taught by Bill Apter, the greatest wrestling journalist in the history of wrestling. And I don't even think a McMahon would disagree with that statement. So
I don't think anybody can.
It was an honor working for Bill Apter. It was an honor being discovered by Bill Apter. And I take everything he taught me moving forward, even though I have the 100% creative control and freedom. Regarding language, I do a 30-to-1-hour show every week on all of Vince Russo's networks. I might throw a shit in there. If I'm really angry, I might drop one F-bomb in an episode. But I keep the swearing to a minimum because Bill Apter said it like this. Once something's out there, you can never take it back.
Very true.
So,
very true.
Before you speak.
Very, very true. I think it's pretty. It's a great thing to be able to work in different facets and learn as much as you can. So, it's once we stop learning, we stop growing, we stop creating, great things. So, good on you, Mr. Corbeil. Good on you.
And I still love my One Wrestling family. Mm-hmm. Big Ray.
How is your relationship there with One Wrestling? Is it still solid? You still talk to those guys on a regular basis?
Most of them. The network has grown when it pertains to more people producing content there. So some of the newer people, I can't make that statement. But Big Ray, Bill Schuyler, Billy Ray Valentine, 8-Track Brown, The Professor, I all speak with those gentlemen.
Awesome.
On a regular basis.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Big shout out to OneWrestling.com.
Some of the new guys, I don't even want to draw blanks, but my One Wrestling family is my One Wrestling family. And if you don't follow Bill Schuyler, Big Ray, The Professor, 8-Track Brown, Bill Apter, you're doing yourself a disservice as a wrestling fan.
Agreed. Agreed. All right. That's a good cap around question number two. Let's move seamlessly into question number three. Working for both men and knowing all the people that you know in the industry, What do you think is the biggest misconception out there by fans, you know, in the public opinion today, either about someone specific or wrestling in general? There's a lot to choose from, I know.
Yeah, there really is. There really is.
What's the one you think?
I think
the
biggest misconception out there is the fact that a lot of people claim that PG is leading towards the death of professional wrestling. Mm-hmm. I disagree, not wholeheartedly, but I think it's creative that is stagnant. I think there's too many cooks in the kitchen in World Wrestling Entertainment, too many writers. That hive mind doesn't necessarily work. And it seems that that's what World Wrestling Entertainment is trying to have within their creative, is that hive mind mentality. You go back to Vince and Ed Ferrara, two guys just sitting there, whether it be in the living room, at the kitchen table, writing a damn show. And too many cooks spoil the pot. So I think that's the biggest misconception, is that the PG era is killing professional wrestling. It's lazy creative and too many cooks in the kitchen.
Yeah, I think when you have 24 writers, which is the last, you know, that's the last count that we got, was 24 writers on the staff. And even that itself is not the biggest problem. But when you have 24 writers who are micromanaged by one guy, because Vince is still known to be quite the micromanager, even at, you know, his advanced age of 72. From what we understand, there is a little bit, you know, less of that, but still, that is a problem. I mean, you have 24 people who are writing the show, and then you have one guy who still wants it a specific way. It sends mixed messages. But I'm 100% agreement with you. PG is
and
not
like
a problem.
And like I said, too many cooks in the kitchen, Dave.
Yeah.
Put 24 cooks in the kitchen. What's going to happen? You're going to have a bunch of ideas bumping and clashing into each other. No smooth progressional conclusions to anything.
Absolutely. That's why.
Thank God there is that filter, that last stage, Vincent McMahon.
McMahon. God. One day you and I will have a conversation. We're going to have a conversation about broken Matt Hardy one day. Not today, because I don't want to get dragged out of here in handcuffs, but one day we will have that conversation. Oh, man. McMahon.
1 second, Dave.
I know what's coming. Oh, I think I have an idea of what's coming.
People talk again and again and again as the wrestling world is dilapidated, but I don't believe that. I believe they are fools, imbeciles. I don't know, whatever.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Oh, my God, Matt Hardy. Wow. Whew, that's a conversation for another day. All right, that's good stuff. Question number four. One of the reasons why I like watching you is the interviews that you're able to get. It's like a Jay Leno mentality. I love David Letterman, but back in the day, but I watched Leno because he got everybody. You seem to be able to do that wonderfully. So, real simple. What do you feel is your best interview? At what interview do you wish that you can forget?
The phenomenal one, AJ Styles, 90-minute interview. We had him starting the interview where he's like sitting on his couch and he's like, geez, I feel like I should have came in and made an entrance, because I announced him with all of his credentials and what he had done and blah,
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 blah. It's a
long list. and the reason why this was probably my favorite interview is AJ was very calm, serious, and professional in the beginning. And by the end, we had him throwing the IWGP World Heavyweight Championship around on the couch and talking about video games and acting like a comfortable, young, youthful, exuberant person. So
that interview, he was like one of the guys by the end of it. He was one of the guys. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And, we've stayed friends to this day. Even talked to him before winning the title.
Oh, that's
awesome. He didn't let me know he was winning, though, the prick, but whatever. I have no hard feelings for AJ. The worst interview.
Yeah, what's the one that you had to take a shower
after?
Now.
What was that?
What was the one that you had to take a shower after to get off of you? Eesh.
Oh, geez. I really like this talent. I interviewed a person. I'm not going to mention his name. He's a multi-time champion, and he had the worst dragon breath for 14 minutes. I was trying to breathe through the side of my mouth, and it was brutal. It was a good interview, though. But holy geez, those little clothespin digs over my nose would have really helped progress the interview on a grand stage. My worst interview.
Have you ever had anyone walk out on you?
I'd have to say MVP.
Ooh.
And it has nothing to do with content. It has to do with, it was during a time right after he left TNA. We talked about that. Mm-hmm. But he kind of had a real sour feeling for the wrestling reporting aspect of the industry. He didn't even want to do the interview at first, but after shooting the shit, him, myself, Lance Storm, and Chelsea Green, we were all sitting in the dressing room having a conversation. Then he decided to finally do the interview. Like I said, it was a good interview, but what made it shitty was he had that gripe with pro wrestling media at the time, and he made me put my phone down on the table, so it was a blackout interview.
Really?
So I was kind of pissed off with that, but wow. They're all good interviews, bro.
That's very true. It's like, especially even a bad one where somebody would freak out, if that were to happen, it's still good content.
I think my first ever interview was a little shaky. Mm-hmm. Mick Foley.
That was your first interview, was Mick Foley. Wow.
Yeah, talk about getting thrown in the fire right off the bat, right?
And Mick would seem to be a really easy one to pop your cherry on because he's so talkative and he's so,
presentable. But, there was a time where I'd go into my interviews with some pre-bullet points prepared. Mm-hmm. But I just dive into it off the top of my head now. I've done over 60 interviews with various superstars in the industry. And it feels second nature now, but I go back to that Mick Foley interview. I was so damn nervous. The guy has so much that he's done in the business for accolades. How am I going to introduce this guy? what if I'm, you know what I mean? Just uncertainty, nervousness.
Sure, but especially when it's a guy like Mick Foley. You mess up, you feel like, oh, I'll never get anybody now. It's good that...
Yeah, it's not like my first interview was Joe Blow McGee.
Right, yeah.
From XYWCY Wrestling, you know?
It's like you're stepping right in there. This is a make-or-break moment. And obviously, it went pretty well.
Yeah.
Here you stand.
Yeah. So I'm really comfortable within just going in and doing it. Yeah. I have a Magnus interview coming this week. And we sat down. All the prep we had was, I said, grab the title so we can showcase it for the fans, and I'll start off with Gladiators.
Oh,
Dad, I'm a guy that's comfortable in my skin. I've always been comfortable with myself. That's why I'm not too shy to be a little bit of a jester, a clown, a jackass. I don't mind embarrassing myself for a laugh.
I think that's important.
I can laugh.
I think that's really important in this industry, in wrestling and in podcasting. But I mean, when you combine them together, especially. You gotta have a thick skin.
If you're
skin.
Not thick-skinned, to the wrestling fans tuning in to Dead on Dave's questions here, if you're not a thick-skinned talent, you're not going to go anywhere in this industry.
No, none. You're not making it. It's just not happening. You got to be able to take anything that people say. And more importantly, you got to be able to put yourself out there in ways that most people just don't have the... I don't want to say balls because it's a hard thing to do, but they don't have the willingness to do it. It's a hard thing to...
Yeah, gumption. The gumption.
The gumption. I like that. See, that's wonderful. That's exactly. Now, as a rider onto that question, this isn't the final question. Now, this is a rider to the last question. Now, people know that one of the things that you're most known for is, you know, your relationship with the Hart family. You interview a lot, everybody from the Hart family. You've sat down with all of them. You've had some fantastic moments with them. Explain a little bit about that relationship with the Harts, how it came to be, and how important it is to you professionally and personally.
It was almost like it was meant to be, Dave. Mm-hmm. And I'm not trying to say that cliche-wise. It all started through Diana. Diana and I randomly started talking one day. We decided to go meet for coffee. We really enjoyed each other's company. Started to build a bond, a trust, and it just went from there. It was the British Bulldog, Davy Boy Smith Jr. Next. Then it began. It got to the point where I was being invited to family functions.
Oh wow!
Like Harry Smith's birthday party, Stu Hart's 100%, 100%. Stu Hart's 100. What do you call that? Centennial birthday. Obviously, Stu Hart passed on many years ago, but the family celebrated what would have been his 100th birthday, and I was a part of that.
That's incredible.
Booking meetings with them. Again, this goes back to the layers of curtains within the industry. I got to book with Smith Hart, planning the show, creating the card. Do you know how, here comes the one F-bomb. Do you know how fucking cool that was?
Oh, I can imagine. Mind-blowing.
And whether it be Diana, Harry, Brett, Matt Hart, all of them, Smith, Georgia, I could go on and on and on. Teddy saved my ass on the side of the road. Matt Hart and I were on a wrestling road trip, and I kind of was hard on my Cadillac, and I blew the engine on the side of the road in the middle of nowhere, Dave. No joke. And it was Teddy Hart that drove 2 hours out of Calgary to come pick us up on the side of the road to get us to safety, you know? So it's been a whirlwind around the Harts. Tragedy, trife, successes, just... It's all out there, fans. You know, right?
Yeah,
they're still a great family, a diverse family. Not everybody gets along.
Oh, sure.
But you got to make that in a family of that many children,
and all in the same industry. I mean, it's the Harts are probably the one true royal family of wrestling. I mean, I know we got the Samoan Dynasty and the Rhodes, you know, and many, many others. And the Von Erichs, all these guys. Nobody has had the longevity or pageantry accolades as the Hart family, plain and simple. There's not another family that's even close to it. And you know, I've taken exception with things that Bret Hart has done in the past, things that he has said. I feel that, you know, he can be. I don't go to the extremes of
something. He's bitter. He's bitter.
He does have that tendency. I just don't like some of the things that he'll do without thinking about other men. Like what he did to Natalya, when he put her out on the ledge like that, I feel he really did kind of, you know, screw the pooch. But other than that, listening to Bret Hart, listening to other members of the Hart family, it really is an incredible experience, because you almost have to listen to it blindly, because if you're going to listen to one family, it's going to be them. It's the Hart family. It's pretty incredible. That's awesome that you have such a good relationship with them.
And we all know that the wrestling business is mainly toying with the fans' emotions
at all times.
You know, so when a whole family has wrestling etched within that family, you have ribs.
Yeah.
Davy Boy Smith Jr., Harry Smith, one hell of a ribber. I get crank calls about scratches on my car, and it's I'm not even going to go into it. Actually, I will go into it. Harry and I, we were going to watch one of the UFC fights at one of the bars here, Buffalo Bills or Buffalo Wild Wings or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And Harry got me to call this limousine driver and say, hey, you got to go out to the farm. You got to pick up the wrestling ring. There's a case of beer and a carton of smokes for you. The limousine driver doesn't drink and doesn't smoke and blah, 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 blah. He's like, but I don't drink. I don't smoke. That doesn't matter. You got to get out there. Go get your beer. Go get your smokes. You got to take down the ring. We got to get it into the city. And Harry's just laughing his ass off in the back row. But anyway, long story short, this is a family of ribbers on one side, and the other side is nurturing. You know, it's a big family. Every member of the family ate at the dinner table every Sunday for decades. Even though there's division in the family, it's still togetherness no matter what. Blood is thicker than water.
Absolutely. awesome. That's incredible. I could do an entire show with you just talking about the Hart family, but I will digress and we'll move on to question number five, sir. Everything that you've accomplished up to this point, which is quite a lot. I mean, working for the people that you have, there still always has to be something that you're looking forward to in the future. So real simple. What's your dream job, man? What's the ultimate goal for Andre Corbeil?
Ultimate dream job?
Man, what's that thing that you are striving for? At the end of the day, your legacy will be...
There is a network up here called Sportsnet.
Mm-hmm. Renee, there's also a network for Sportsnet, yeah.
There's also a network up here called FightNet, the Fight Network.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to be a traveling correspondent for one of the two.
Oh, cool. That's pretty
get cool. Paid to go interview people, fly me around, lodge me, feed me,
the whole shebang.
Treat me good, pay for my massages.
Yes, right. No happy endings, Andre. No, they don't pay for that part of it.
Why did I go there?
I don't. Especially with me, you knew where I was going to go with. I'm a simple man. That's pretty cool. That's a good goal.
Hey, wait. Put the brakes right there.
Yes, sir.
Did I just hear Dead on Dave say that he's a simple man?
Simple. I'm very simple. Very.
That is the misstatement of the year.
I don't know what you mean by that. I'm a very, very
you're,
simple
I think
man.
You're a highly intelligent man, and I think you're more complex than you let off there, Dave.
Well, I appreciate that. I do. I very much appreciate that.
And I don't know why I'm getting all these advertisements. Educate the girls, change the world. Girlsrising.com. Holy feminism right in your
Yeah, what are you on right now? What site are you looking at?
I keep getting some advertisement on Skype and
advertisements everywhere. Jesus.
Power to my girls out there. Power to my girls out there, but the main word is equality.
Yes.
Exactly. You know, it needs to stop at some point.
Absolutely. I mean, you don't gain equality by putting down the people who you feel were oppressing you. I mean, it's...
And creating inequality. Yes, exactly. It's almost like a double-edged sword.
Yeah, it's a paradox. It's a paradox. It's crazy. I do have a bonus question for you. Before I let you turn the tables, this has gone so well, better than I could have ever possibly imagined. I got a bonus question for you. And sure. I think you're going to like it. I had this one set up. TNA.
Dun, dun,
we're going to get
dun,
into TNA for dun, just a moment. Dun, dun. This is the one. This is the loaded question.
What? I missed all of that because I was doing the Jaws movie.
Well, everybody knows the one thing about you is not only are you a correspondent for Corbeil and all, or for Russo and after, but you are one of the main TNA correspondents, period. Some
I'm
call
not saying
you,
this to brag, but probably the most trusted TNA guy.
For good or bad, you are ride or die with TNA. So... I'm going to ask you straight out without all of the, some people would say rose colored glasses, whatever the case may be. What are your true thoughts right now with TNA from conception to now and why the loyalty? I mean, I understand being a fan, but your loyalty to TNA is something that is unbelievably impressive. And it seems to exist on a very intimate and personal level. Why do you think that is?
Can I answer in Frenchy Ben mode?
Yes.
Say sucker de MSD, they call this tabernacle. Those goddamn people there, they don't like that a woman ran the company. They don't like that the number two get the whoop. Anyway, I'm just going to stop there.
I'm French Canadian, so any French people watching going, hey, this jackass is insulting French people, I'm laughing at myself.
Exactly.
I was a WCW guy.
As was I, yeah.
I was very hurt when WCW closed up shop.
Yeah.
All of the fans that were fans of Ted Turner's company, half of them disappeared.
Yeah.
That demographic has never returned to professional wrestling. Now, a lot of people figured that they migrated to UFC waters, mm-hmm. those fans. But... only a small portion, a small ratio, a percentage of those WCW fans migrated to WWE after they bought out the company.
Yep.
I had stopped watching WWE for a year due to that invasion angle when all of WCW's top-tiered real superstars sat at home with Fat Turner contracts.
Yes, they did.
And these C-plus players with a few stars meshed in were paraded on WWF at the time, TV, made to look like clowns. I get it, McMahon won, blah, 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 blah. That speech that he gave should have been enough and get over it.
You would think.
That invasion angle really killed everything in my heart for wrestling. I stopped watching. A year later, I was at a barbecue with my buddies, and we saw a one-cent deal on a wrestling pay-per-view I'd never heard of, TNA. We got it for the penny, and AJ Styles, Jerry Lynn, Ken Shamrock, so many other superstars won me over that night. Yeah. And it relit that fire, reignited my passion for wrestling. And that's where the never die part comes from.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was fucking done with wrestling, Dave.
Oh, I can imagine.
A kid that had watched all my life up until that invasion angle. Yeah. I was done. So it took that 1 cent pay-per-view to reignite the fire. So I appreciate TNA for that regard.
Mm-hmm.
The company's went through lots of different eras. Ooh, Dave.
Hasn't it?
Good, bad, medium, ugly, beautiful, a web.
Yeah.
A web. But I truly think under the guise of Billy Corgan, the change is coming within the company. And I don't like to report things before they're finalized.
There's a lot of rumor going around right now, yeah.
I might do the odd spoiler regarding a faction or this and that and that and this, but I usually like to wait until things are official.
Mm-hmm. Jim Ross kind of jumped the gun. I don't know if you saw the Jim Ross thing that he put out last night. Very interesting comments from JR, who does not do things like this. And what he said, I'm not asking you to confirm or deny any of it. I just want to get your opinion on it. What JR is stating and what's really going around is the video library seems to be back on the table to be purchased by WWE with Billy Corgan actually, in fact, buying TNA from Dixie and kind of rebranding it, reshuffling it, and making it his own entity. That's what JR is reporting. Now, I don't know if this is 100% true, but he seems to be right. When he does do things like this, they seem to be fairly accurate. That was the one thing that I was not expecting, for them to sell their previous library and then essentially become something evolved. That might be the best case scenario.
If that was to come to pass, Dave, it would almost be like a kid on a bike with training wheels needing that inaugural push to get that momentum. If Billy was to buy the company and sell the library, that would create a lot of financial breathing room for the company.
Indeed it would.
The problem is that WWE would want a no compete. You know what I'm saying? A clause.
Yes.
So I think negotiations like this would take a lot longer than are being presented.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when two sides see differently.
Do you think that
now, I don't think Billy, why? I don't think Billy would, what was that?
Do you think that could be why the funding has been granted to get TNA through the rest of the year? Do you think that could be a reason as to why those were Ditsy's? Oh, I didn't mean to do that. Dixie's words. I didn't mean to do that. That was completely accidental. I actually don't hate Dixie Carter. Everybody else seems to. I actually don't hate her. I'm not sure she's right for TNA by any stretch, but I don't hate her. So that was an accident. But from her own words, I mean, getting that funding to get them through December, do you think that could have a reason for it to allow those negotiations to happen?
See, some people are reporting that TNA is all good until the end of the year when it comes to tapings and all of that. That's not the case.
Oh, okay.
They're taped till the end of November.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, in the can, that's what Vince Russo likes to call it, tucked away in the can, is up till November. Now, people would think, okay, they're going to need to do four shows for December. That's not the case. They usually have Christmas and New Year's, the greatest of or best of. So technically, they need to come up with two more. So one show, one night.
Essentially, one more taping night, yeah.
So they will require one more night before having the year wrapped up, before the Maximum Impact Tour 9, which is... Also, financially, what helps TNA the most is their big tour in the UK. So, anybody thinking that TNA is on the Ixnay, on the way out, they got another thing coming. You got another thing coming.
And personally, I don't think that TNA needs to go. Look, I'm not the biggest fan.
The three letters,
you know,
TNA, are in trouble.
Yes.
I think they're on the way out.
I think you're right.
Like I said, I don't like to report anything until it's finalized.
I think you're right about that.
But I'll hint to you guys, that would make the most sense that,
Impact Wrestling. I think they tried to get behind that name and didn't stick. I think it will in the future. A lot of people are like, why can't TNA just
come? If the library's for sale, that they could sell it under the guise of TNA and still keep the Impact Wrestling. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And I think it's a win-win
situation. But
that all
comes down to negotiations.
Yeah, and I think they'll get there. I really do, because it makes too much sense. There's no reason for Vince to not want something with the heritage of Impact Wrestling to continue. It's good for business. If Impact can actually become viable and get a market share and challenge and get people to the table, it really does only help the entire industry, which is kind of hurting at the moment. So... I don't think he has anything to fear.
But if that comes to pass, Dave, comes to fruition, and Vince does get the library, it's kind of a different situation. He doesn't kill the company.
Exactly.
The company doesn't go away. The company, he actually helps the company with that boost of finance.
Absolutely.
This is kind of like a 180 to all of the other situations where over the years McMahon has gobbled up a company or purchased its bankruptcy or so on and so forth.
And I think it's because of the existence of the network. That network is, I think the network is more important to the future of wrestling than people understand. I think that there could be a thing with the network that one day other wrestling organizations can use that as a Netflix. I think one day we could see an Impact Wrestling program, as crazy it might sound now, I'm talking down the line, it would make sense for everybody to have one thing that is able to get out to everybody. And
yeah, Big Ray and I did a show at One Wrestling where we talked about Hulu, Netflix, and Impact Wrestling benefiting from going on those.
I think the WWE Network is eventually the destination. It's infrastructure strong. It's kept its subscribers when a lot of people didn't think it would. And getting the library that they're getting, if they're able to get the TNA library, it makes sense for them. I mean, it really does. They got a lot of
TNA
AJ
Styles,
guys.
Bobby Roode, Sting, all of those. Even when Kurt Angle comes back, it would allow them to. Kurt Angle had a longer career in TNA wrestling. I don't know if a lot of people know that.
Since 2006. It's a longer career. But,
he had a more lengthy career in TNA Impact Wrestling. So when it comes to Kurt Angle coming back and eventually retiring, I think it would be good to have the complete puzzle.
Absolutely.
But this is all speculation.
It is.
I'm not Vince McMahon. You're not Ditzy Carter.
That was such an accident. Don't tell her I said that, man. I'm never going to get her on now. Like I had a shot. Thanks for being so candid with me about the TNA stuff. I know it's not easy being a defender of TNA.
You got to realize, though, I'm kind of bound when it comes to TNA because... I have 15 contacts, insiders within the company that I can contact either via phone or some form. I'm kind of bound in that regard. I'm careful what I say.
Which is a good thing. Yeah. It's a smart thing to be careful about what you say. Well, you got to protect your sources. You got to make sure you're not throwing people under the bus, all of these things. And I don't think people
understand. And that's what it comes down to. That's what it comes down to, Dave, when you said earlier about my ability to get countless interviews like that kind of thing.
It's, people come to you for a reason.
Once you build that trust factor and make that name that you're for the boys, you're not going to throw anybody under the bus, you're not all about the scandalous tagline or whatever. It just when I had Magnus on, you think I asked him if he ever had relations with Dixie Carter and if that had to do with his decision and cause problems or within his wife or you know what I'm saying? Just
sure.
Wow, I just butchered it.
No, you didn't. You hit it spot on because you don't shoot yourself in the foot. People come to you for a reason. They trust you. And that might sound silly to people who don't understand, because people like to say, well, wrestling journalism isn't a real thing. Even if people want to say that that is a reality, which is, it's not the case. It is a real thing. It is an institution. You have real relationships with these people, and it allows you to get them on and be candid with you and vulnerable. I mean, you got AJ Styles to throw around his damn IWGP title. I mean, that's an incredible thing to be able to do. And you're able to accomplish that with almost everybody. It's because of the trust and the rapport that you have with people.
And you know what? We edited it out. But you know what one of the funniest parts of that interview was?
What's that?
When we were talking about the idea that I should go get the title. I asked him, I said, where's the title right now, AJ? He's like, oh, it's outside in the truck.
I love the idea of that. The WWE title right now is sitting in that very same trunk. How awesome would that be?
Yeah.
One final thing before I turn it over to you and let you get your revenge on me, your question of revenge. You do have a relationship with AJ Styles, like you said, and you're friends with him. What was him winning the title? What did that mean to you? Because that's something that people did not think was going to happen. I had it called from day one because I had a good idea what they paid that man. I had a good idea of what they were letting him do. I'm the one guy who was sitting there going, AJ will be a champion in WWE and eat everybody who doesn't think so. So what did that mean to you, Andre, when he won that belt?
I lost all composure on video. I did a reaction video where I'm going, fuck yes! Yeah, I fucking told you! I lost all my composure. I guess I marked out.
Yeah, it happens to the best of us.
It added another layer considering the fact that I was talking to him just days before and he didn't even give me a hint.
Nope. He's a professional, that's why. Or maybe he didn't know.
That's what one of my buddies said. That's what Billy Ray Valentine said. Maybe he didn't know till they got to the arena, bro.
Very possible.
You got a point.
This is WWE we're talking about. It's very possible that he did not know. But I think
4 hours before Raw, we're rewriting the show.
We're rewriting it. Hunter's going to get in there and he's going to turn on Rollins. Ah, I think it's wonderful. AJ's absolutely killing it right now.
It was a good write-up.
I love that you held the nose to do that. I love what AJ's doing as champion, by the way. I think he's absolutely killing it right now. And
he earned it.
Hell yeah.
He earned it. Big splash at the Royal Rumble. Then he was a pin cushion for a while.
A little bit. I mean, he was in some high profile.
He did everything that was asked of him by the McMahons. And slowly but surely, TNA man, Mr. TNA or not, made believers out of all of them.
Hell yeah.
And look at where he's at now.
He's at the top. And
the face that runs the place, the face. And you know what? It all started with this. It all started with this. And it all started with Vince Russo and the guitar shot from Vince
That's
Russo.
That's right. People forget that Russo and AJ had a storyline in the early days. That's right. That's 100% true. You could consider what you feel about that particular storyline, but yeah, that did happen. That's true. All right, my friend. I think that you more than satisfied my curiosities deep down in the cockles of my heart. So thank you very much
for hopefully
that.
I satisfied your viewers.
I think you did. I think you did. So here's what we're going to do now. I'm going to turn it over to you, let you ask any one question to me that you might have. And then if you have a couple more minutes, I'd like to maybe open up the phone line, see if some callers might have a question or two for you. Are you down for that?
All right.
Awesome.
Currently, Dave.
Yes, sir.
Currently, Dave, who is the most overrated wrestler in the industry?
Active?
Currently.
Okay. Yeah, look, that would be the correct word. Okay. Oh boy. I got a shocker. Will Ospreay.
The Shockmaster?
No, yes. That's right. Yeah, Tugboat. No, Will Ospreay. I think he is one of the most physically gifted wrestlers I've ever seen in my life. That match with Ricochet, I will not shit on. I will not do any of the things that we've seen people do. It was a great form of entertainment. Will Ospreay has a few problems in his game. Major problems, connectivity problems. I like to call them Cesaro problems. Because as amazing as Cesaro is, and all the people who like to say that they love Cesaro, there is a problem, and it is a reason why he will never be a main guy in any organization, not just WWE. I see the same problems in Will Ospreay, as much as I love him, and I think he's great. But I think with all the fervor that goes around with his name and everything that happened with Vader and all these things that we've seen, I think the most overrated name right now in professional wrestling is Will Ospreay.
I would have to say Roman Reigns.
See, I don't overrate him.
And I'm not even a hater of the guy. I just see a tub of plain yogurt.
I don't overrate him though. So
I'm not saying he's shitty. I'm not saying he doesn't have talent. I'm not saying he doesn't have strength. I'm not saying he's got the looks to bring in the female viewers. I'm just saying when I look at him, I see a tub of yogurt with no flavor to it.
No flavor. I agree with that. I do agree with that. Roman, you know, he has improved. I have to give him some credit, man. I mean, like...
Well, with each passing day within your profession, if you don't improve, you're in the wrong profession.
Very true. But there was a time where he wasn't. He was not improving. He was getting worse. It was getting really ugly there for a while. And then he had his suspension. He took it like a man. He took it like a champ. And came back, and now he's doing...
Yeah, he took it like a champ.
No, somebody else probably did it for him, Andre. Get it right. I don't... And it's usually in the ass, sorry, right in the butt.
I'm sorry, fans of Roman Reigns. Like I said, I dished out 5-6 compliments to the guy. Exactly. I just see plain yogurt.
Don't now, worry, there's no women or children here. You're fine.
I'm going to 180 this on you, Dave.
Yes, sir.
Now, who's the most underrated talent in the industry?
Ooh.
I'll give you my answer, too.
Okay. All right. Let me think here. This is a tough one. This is actually a really tough one. Man, you know, this is going to be a weird answer because he's currently one of the hottest names in wrestling and people who know my channel know the name I'm about to give. The most underrated guy for people who are not expecting him to do what I feel he's going to do when he does get up to WWE, it's Shinsuke Nakamura. And now I can understand people are going to be like, how can he possibly be underrated? Not enough people are understanding what I feel he's going to accomplish when he gets up to WWE. It's going to be something that we have not seen in about 20 years. That guy is
You think he's going to be that breakthrough Asian star that Vince McMahon says, I'm going to push this guy.
I do. I think he will either at this WrestleMania, but more likely the WrestleMania after, he will be headlining and he will be the guy to beat Brock Lesnar. And his
now what Nakamura does possess is that flair, that charisma that a lot of Asian performers that came into WWE didn't have or didn't have the chance to really showcase.
Yeah, he's not Kai and Tai. So, yeah.
yeah, well, that was kind of a comedy thing, you know?
It was, yeah. Taka Michinoku was a great wrestler.
It worked. Kai and Tai worked.
Yeah.
You know? But,
I was a big Taka Michinoku fan, man. I like Taka. He was a badass.
very aerialistic. Yeah, I liked him too. I liked him too.
So
I liked his driver. I like his driver finisher. It was nice.
Yeah, I liked it better when it was the Hoovy driver.
I personally think the most underrated talent in wrestling right now is Pentagon Jr. in Lucha Underground.
Ooh, that's interesting. I think there's something to that.
What was that, buddy?
I think there's something to that. I think because of all the people that I'm thinking about in Lucha that I watched, I constantly want to turn the channel on. Pentagon's not one of them. I think you're 100% right.
He plays an unbelievable character that is strangely and oddly enough believable.
Yeah. Yeah. And in a I very bizarre company.
An arm breaker. Yeah. He's going to tear your arm off. You know, and that's... I don't like the new name they gave him, Pentagon Dark.
Yeah, right.
Like, what is he, a fucking chocolate bar? Kit Kat Dark.
That's right. You know what we're going to do? We're gonna repackage him. Now he's dark. And like this Emelina thing that we're about to get. What the hell is Emelina?
I'm waiting for Pentagon Mocha to debut next year.
Where's Pentagon Light? Is he coming down the pipe too? No, that's racist.
Pentagon Light.
It's coming.
Emma.
Emelina.
We shall see how this is. Anything to push her, anything to give her that spot. She is so much better than a lot of the other women wrestlers that have gotten pushes.
Yes.
This woman can stretch you out on the mat. This woman can do it looking beautiful. And I just think WWE's done her a disservice. Oh, so I'm going to give this character a chance. She still looks
smoking hot. I feel that there's a problem.
There's so much
now.
Of that in the division already.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit of a problem.
What?
I think there might be a little bit of a problem. They're taking away that what's making her so special. She's not the same girly girl that we've seen in the past in WWE and some currently. Emma, when she became Evil Emma, she transformed into Evil Emma after that awful run.
See, I missed all of that because I do not watch NXT.
Really? Andre? Oh.
No interest in a farm league. No interest in a farm league.
It's not a farm league, man.
WWE, it's a feeding system farm league promotion.
They don't treat it that way, man. The way they book it.
I understand.
If you get a chance, I think.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
Oh, I understand.
And I don't like the crowd. They seem like oddities to me.
There's a lot of dead on Dave.
I really don't like
crowd.
The feel of the show, Dave. I'm sorry.
Really? I'm a little surprised.
Bill Skyler.
Yeah.
Come on, Andre. You got to give it a chance. And I did. It's not shitty. Don't get me wrong.
Personally, I think it's the best product on television right now. I got to be honest with you.
Just didn't grab it. See, I think Lucha Underground is.
Really? I can't get through it.
Yes.
It's too bizarre for me.
And this is coming from the TNA guy, Dave.
Yeah, it's very odd. I mean, like, Lucha for me is just a never-ending final deletion. And I can't do that to myself on a weekly basis, Andre. I can't do it. I'll blow my brains out, man. I can't do it. It's just too bizarre. And I'm a wrestling guy, and I understand that wrestling is all about suspending your disbelief. I think they take it a step too far.
So are movies.
Yeah, but wrestling isn't movies. Wrestling, it's not the same for me. And they try to integrate it too much. I'm waiting for them to all become vampires since it's a damn Robert Rodriguez joint. Everyone's going to be vampires eventually. You mark my fucking words.
But Dave, you're not going to – well, I'm not going to come home from a movie theater and go, you know what, that movie was okay, but – where the fuck did the guy's webs stick to? Are they going to stick to the clouds? So I think the movie sucked.
Yeah, it's a different thing for me. I don't have that feeling about movies or other television. But when it's about wrestling, I guess I have that old school mentality. There's just certain things that I can't buy in the context of wrestling. And maybe I'm missing out.
And that's fine.
Yeah.
And that's totally fine, Dave. Look at us. I'm talking... defending Lucha Underground, you're talking defending NXT.
Yeah.
It just shows that there are diverse products out there for every different kind of wrestling fan and in between.
Absolutely.
And that's the most important point, is in between.
There is because no correct way to do wrestling, man. If you're entertaining people and you are doing things that people want to pay money to see, then you are doing it right. Plain and simple.
Just think of Joey Ryan suplexing a guy by the balls.
I can't deal with that. I can't deal with that.
For me, I don't give two shits about that kind of wrestling. I really don't.
I
don't care about seeing tube lights getting smashed over people. And I do enjoy hardcore wrestling to a degree.
Sure.
But it's almost like supersized, you know? I want a pop or a soda, but I don't want the supersize, you know?
Yeah, I don't drink an entire 2 liter. Yeah, I'm with you on there.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys have 2 liters in Canada. You might.
Yes,
like
we do, brother. Yes,
pints
we do.
Or quarts. I don't know.
Metric system. No, this is metric system here too.
I'm in the metric system. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. Yeah.
So you travel in kilometers and meters.
That's right. We do. And yes, now with Pokemon Go, everybody does. So it's good times for all.
Hey, just don't get hit by a car, bro.
All right. Let's turn it over to the fans for a moment. Let's take a couple fan questions. Not sure if we're going to get any. We might. And this is your chance to ask Andre Corbeil, one of the most connected men in the industry today, working for Vince Russo. He's worked for Bill After. He has interviewed some of your greatest heroes in the history of wrestling. Now's your chance. If you have a question, call in right now on Skype, David Vancura, DavidVancura, or the number 702-751-2902. If not, we'll get the hell up out of here. Call it a day. So while we're waiting for that message to get across, is there any final thoughts that you'd like to divulge to the people? Anything you'd like people to know about you that maybe doesn't get asked and you would like to be asked about you? Like the real Andre Corbeil deep down inside.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far away, there was a little frog / Polish English kid born. Now, he was a hyper child, an energetic child, often got in a little bit of mischief. But at the same time, he was an observant child, a prolific child that grew up loving professional wrestling. Now, it was his grandparents ultimately that got him into wrestling, and without them, it never would have come to pass. So as Gandalf said, Gandalf the Grey, "You shall not pass." Oh. I don't know why that
you know, it works. It plays. We do have a couple questions in the chat. Go ahead.
I was turned on to wrestling by my grandparents. I thank them for it. And it really brought the family together. It gave us something to look forward to. I've always loved wrestling, except for that 1 year, like I said earlier in the video.
Yeah. I'm with you. I'm very much beholden to my father. He's the one who got me into wrestling. I remember as a little kid, he used to put me on his couch. We used to watch Crockett Cup tapes, man. Old Crockett Cup promotion tapes. Yeah, that's what I grew up on. So we do have a couple questions.
I love the NWA, man. I really loved the NWA.
It was something really special.
I think it was the greatest wrestling promotion of all time.
If we're talking no frills, absolutely. I think you might be 100% right. I mean,
and the outreach. You look at all of the people that were involved to make the NWA a running machine.
Yeah, NWA is still going around. It's not what it once was, of course, but I mean, it's still
disappointing,
exists.
Bro.
I know. I don't watch it as much, but it's still there. And that does my heart well. Is it what it was? No, but does my heart well. Does my heart well.
Hey, and there's a little hint. There's a little hint. That Dragon Breath interview that I was talking about, it was an NWA champion.
Ooh, I like that.
So even though I said I wouldn't give the name out, there's the hint. Let's see if you sleuths.
That's right. People are going to be searching through everything. People are going to be looking for your interviews where your eyes are watering a little bit. Your nose hair burns just a tiny bit.
Nice way to get them to visit the channel, eh?
It's pretty smart. You learned a couple things from that Vince Russo, I see. That's good stuff.
Twitter's your thing, fans. You can follow me at Andre_Corbeil or at Can-Am Wrestling. Andre Corbeil on YouTube and Wrestling News Talk on Facebook.
Well, there you have it. We'll get you out of here on this. I got a couple of quick questions for you in the chat, and then we'll get you out of here.
Oh, we did get something.
We got a couple questions in the chat, so we'll go through them, and we'll get you out of here on that. Derek Bradford in the chat says, Andre, who is your favorite person to interview? You're just your favorite person yet you've ever interviewed. I think you already answered that, but to reiterate, because Derek doesn't listen.
No. The AJ Styles was the best interview, but I wouldn't say it was my favorite interview.
Oh, okay.
This might surprise a lot of people. He's from the Attitude Era. He used to dress up as Owen Hart and many other characters.
Oh, shit.
Hello?
Are you still there? You're here. Go ahead, Andre.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
I lost her. Ah, Frenchie!
Hey, Andre.
Please continue, Andre.
How you doing? His name is Jason Sensation.
Oh,
he impersonates all of the wrestlers. He can do the best son bitch and Stone Cold Steve Austin you ever heard.
Well, hell, son, you know Stone Cold's gonna come in there and drink a beer and stomp your ass dry.
Hey, what's with Joe Cronin doing Bret Hart? He does a good Bret Hart.
He does do a good Bret Hart. Like, you know, damn Canadians. The Americans, they come in here, the boy toy. I can't do it as well anymore, but yeah, he still does that stuff. We do have a quick caller. I didn't think we were going to get any because Ben took his sweet time, but Frenchie Ben's here. Ben, all yours, buddy.
Hey, Andre. It was a really good interview. Thank you for the Frenchie Ben impersonation.
Oh, it was shitty, bro. You're way better than that.
That's right. I don't have a hockey question, but speaking of TNA, what do you think is Billy Corgan's vision in the future for a wrestling company?
What is Billy Corgan's vision?
Yeah.
I think it'll be a shock-based, darker presentation.
Okay.
With more definitive heels and more definitive baby faces. There's a lot of tweeners in the WWE, guys that are good and bad. Yep. There's only a few heels that are definitive heels, like The Miz, for instance. I think Billy Corgan is a genius. He's proven the creative mind that he has. And not only that, he's been a wrestling fan for decades, all the way back to Vern Gagne's AWA. So I think TNA is in safe waters. I think with Dixie Carter eventually being out of the picture, it'll bring those fans back that said, fuck it, I'm not giving this company my view anymore. So I think it'll be a darker TNA. I think the baby faces will be more definitive within the heels. And I think it'll be shock-based television. Not like the Attitude Era was, but maybe to a percentage or degree.
Hmm.
Do you think he's going to use social media in a new way or a more profound way that WWE does?
What WWE are the masters of is promotion.
Yeah.
They really are. Marketing, promotion, there's nobody better.
Yeah.
When you go to the realm of music, there's not too many people other than Kiss and a few bands out there that have... marketed themselves and branded themselves like Billy Corgan has.
It's very true.
Even going through court battles to cement that branding, which is something Corgan has went through. I think he's TNA's best shot to rebrand, to refocus, and rejuvenate.
Oh, that's good.
Ben, great you got answer. Anything else there, buddy?
A little quick one. Yes or no, the Oilers will do the playoffs?
I think the Oilers will finish ninth in the Western Division this year.
That's right.
So you think that's
have a great year. Yeah,
I think this will be a monumental year for them. This will be the actual flipping of the coin.
The turning point, yeah.
Turning point, thank you. Goddamn TNA pay-per-view and I couldn't even come up with the words.
I'm a wordsmith, Andre. What can I say? Ben, I appreciate
Frenchie, I really enjoy you on Shot from the Point.
Thank you. And I do, I watch your shows from time to time on Russo's channel.
Thank you. Subscribe to my Andre Corbeil channel.
Absolutely. Even though he doesn't show a subscriber count, but subscribe anyway.
It doesn't show the subscriber count?
No, I thought you did that. No, it does not show.
Every time I go on, it shows me.
Well, yeah, for yourself, we can't see it. I want to know. I want to know if you're beating me.
It's pretty decent. It's pretty decent.
You got to be beating me, right? You're beating my ass, right? You got to be.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't really pay attention. After losing a channel of close to 10,000 subs, I really don't pay attention to the subscriber numbers like I used to.
Probably.
I don't even go into my demographics all that much anymore. I just want to bring content to the fans. Paying attention to the stats and everything and focusing so much on growth kind of takes the fun out of it.
Sure.
That's why I'm always quick to do a little plug on video, and that's my marketing. That's my, you know?
Absolutely. I agree with that. That's a smart way of thinking about it.
It takes some of the fun out of the game, you know?
Yeah, I can see that. Ben, I appreciate it, buddy.
What do you think of McDavid? What do you think of McDavid as the new captain, Frenchie?
Oh, it's a good pick. He's really the next Crosby or Wayne Gretzky.
He is.
He seems to have it all. I agree with that.
He's fantastic.
I agree with that.
So hey, have fun in the new stadium, Andrew.
Is it ever freaking gorgeous, isn't it? Wow. I watched a 40-minute video of a guy going through every nook and cranny in the whole place, and I was just like, wow, it's even nicer than I was expecting.
It does look pretty good.
They're saying it's the nicest and most advanced arena in the whole NHL.
Ooh.
That's saying something.
And it could be coming at the right time. So,
yeah. So Godspeed, Andre, and long live the Andre Corbeil channel.
I agree with that shit. See you later, Ben.
Don't ever change that thumbnail, Frenchie. Don't ever change that.
No.
Thank you, Frenchie, Ben. I appreciate it. And thank you, Andre Corbeil, man. This has been an absolute delight. Hope you enjoyed your time on 5 Random Questions. This was a lot of fun for me, man. Thank you so much for stopping by.
I knew I'd have a good time, and no problem, Dave. Anytime in the future, I'll join you for something.
Oh, you heard it here, folks.
I really like your work.
Hey, man, thank you. That means a lot.
Like I said, you're a complex, smart, intellectual individual, and anybody that don't know that is...
They be sleeping, yo. They be sleeping. Thank you very much, Andre. Thanks for everybody for watching it live and everybody who's watching it in the not live context. Thank you very much for checking it out. Make sure you throw a like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and check out my man, Andre Corbeil. He's on my featured channels list on YouTube, right on the main page. Check him out on Twitter, @Andre_Corbeil on Twitter. Go check him out. Andre, it's been a pleasure, my friend. You have yourself a fantastic evening. And you guys have yourself a good night. We'll see you next time right here on Dead on Day Productions. Keep it copious, folks. And as always, if you don't have talent, have talented friends like Andre friggin' Corbeil. He was here. I got him. We'll see you next time. Peace.
Peace, man. That was fun, Dave.